Anybody interested in reading these things, checking whether what this ass is saying is right or wrong? I'll give you some reference. There's a nice article called "Is US Medicine the Best in the World?" That's what you and I think. Especially in India, we have US squared medicine. That is, if US does one thing, we do two things. Or probably one into one square. This is a beautiful study, an audit based on the US government statistics, written by a professor in Johns Hopkins University. Anyway, after writing this article, she dies under mysterious circumstances. Whether somebody bumped her off, I don't know. Her name is Barbara Starfield. Her name was Barbara Starfield. And Barbara brought out so beautifully things. It's a 14-country study, industrialized countries, from Japan to America. And Japan has 120 doctors for 100,000 population, while America has 493 doctors for 100,000 population. Japan's doctors are 99% family physicians, 1% specialists. America, 99.9% are specialists, and 0.1% are family physicians. This is the difference. Japan spends 1/10 of what per capita America spends. But America is the worst of the 14 countries and Japan is the best. Japan people live the longest, have the least number of diseases, and they have very less expense per capita on health care as we call it. And America has the worst in all these parameters. You can imagine what's happening. Now, recently, this year actually, a very important study came out. See why you are frightened, I'll tell you. We have the American College of Cardiology, where about 26,000 fellows are there, and an annual conference, about 20,000 people gather in a city. Only five cities can have it because there's no auditorium to hold 20,000 people. Now, a young boy who was an assistant professor of cardiology in Harvard wrote a letter to the college saying that 20,000 important people who are life-saving people, you take away for 5 days, and what will happen to serious patients in the hospital? So you shouldn't have this kind of a conference. You have smaller conferences in different places. College wrote to him, well, how do you say that? Where is evidence? Then this boy said, okay, I will collect evidence prospectively. So he started in 2004 and went on till 2014, 10 years, mind you. And what he found was something shocking. When these doers, stenters, bypassers and all were away for 5 days, nobody died in the intensive care unit. Serious patients after heart attack, after severe intractable heart failure, they all went home. Not only went home, remained healthy for the next 30 days. And this boy wrote up this paper. It just came out this year. His name is Jaina. Anybody wants to check, please check. You will know. Jaina, A-B, his name. Of course, there are other authors. He is the first author. You write Google, Jaina, A-B, et al., E-T-A-L. In Latin means and others. And the article's name is The Role of Specialists in Treating Heart Diseases. And the journal is journal is called JAMA Internal Medicine. Very important journal of the American Association. Very important journal. You are writing, madam? JAMA Internal Medicine. Very good girl. Right? 2015. And go and read that. It's very interesting. Now, why I'm saying all this is, please don't be under the impression that if you get a disease, you go to a doctor, you will be alright. There's no guarantee. What can doctors do? You know, our father of modern medicine, called Hippocrates, wrote very rightly in 1st century BC. Cure rarely, comma. Comfort mostly, comma. But console always, full stop. This is exactly what we don't do. That's why patients are suffering. We frighten them. If I see a cancer patient, do you know what I tell him? Oh, you have a cancer. You know, you will not live more than 8 months without my treatment. How long will you live with my treatment? Maybe 4 months. That I don't tell you. I'm not joking, seriously. About 6 months ago, they invited me to inaugurate the International Cancer Conference at Tata Cancer Hospital. So I told that director, you know my views. Why do you call me? No, sir, we want you to come. I said, no, I can't wait to the gallery. I have to tell what I feel like. Yes, that's why we are calling it. And there were 500 American delegates, including the president of the American Cancer Society, who is a Nobel laureate, Harold Wamas. And the director is a very nice young man who was in Sloan Kettering Institute. His name is Rajendra Padwe. So I went there, and they said, sir, you inaugurate, you give the keynote address, both together 1 hour. And we don't call any minister. I said, if you are calling ministers, no, I am not coming. But they won't come on time. So you have to wait there. So I told them, you are all frauds. You know it or you don't know, I don't know. If you don't know, I am sorry for you. If you know, change your course. And so many people have told you what you didn't listen. Double Nobel laureate, Linus Pauling said, cancer is a fraud. Everybody says that. So I said, 85% of your research is funded by the industry and you cook up the positive data to satisfy the industry, which has not translated into patient benefit at all. And many of the cancer drugs are not even passed by the FDA. You really hike up the price and they're so expensive that the patient not only dies, the relatives also will be permanently in debt from that. I said, I have a suggestion for you. This Tata Cancer Hospital need not make money, government pays you. So have a palliative unit here. Tell the patients when they come, look, you have two choices. A, you come to us, we have a three-pronged attack, Air Force, Land Artillery, and Navy. What's that? You first mutilate surgery, to remove the part and everything around it, saying that I'm removing everything. You can't remove everything, I'll tell you why. Then you say, now to prevent it, I'll give you chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is poison, 100% poison. It's not proved that chemotherapy doesn't do nothing except to kill the body cells. Then also I will irradiate you and finish you off. In spite of that, if you survive, you are great.
You are really healthy then.
You are very healthy. But in the palliative unit, you give them TLC, tender loving care, plus symptomatic relief. He has pain, relief his pain. And for all you know, he may outlive you. It's true. So they started that now. That day I thought they'll hit me. But they gave a standing ovation at the end for Nara Airport. Then I thought maybe later they'll hit me. They gave a nice lunch in Taj Palace Hotel. They gave me a room in Taj Palace Hotel. Then they said, Harold Wamas and Bidwe want to talk to you in your room. I thought two of them will come and but they came and said, sir, what you said is absolutely true. You only said 85%, but it's 95%. We all know that, but we can't be saying that. We are in the business. So now, the WHO is funding us. Next year, we will have a conference in Paris on contrarian views in cancer. Please come and give the keynote address. I said, fine, I'll do that. Only thing is more people to hit there. This is what's happening. And I'm happy that within 3 months they started the palliative unit. 4 consultants left their job and joined the palliative unit. The palliative unit, today you must go for LC. There's a queue in the palliative unit. There's no queue in the main hospital. Because it's so nice, palliation. And the body alone can kill cancer. Remember that? Body alone kill cancer. Now, having said all this, to defrighten you, medical scare system need not be there because we are there only to help you. There is nothing called cure. Cure, if you know the meaning of the word cure, bringing back the original state. Even a common cold you get, you can't be cured because millions of your nose cells are dead and replaced by fibrosis. But you can heal. Healing is making him old. You know, real healing can happen. But our job is to comfort you. What is the problem with mankind? Whatever disease, pain, suffering. And we have enough methods of easing pain and easing suffering and make life easier. Healing has to be done by your own body. The new biology, I don't know how many of you have studied biology. Good girl, good girl. The biology you studied in school and I studied in school is the wrong biology. That is called the Western dead science. There's a new biology called evolutionary biology. You know, there was no Big Bang. We didn't come from monkeys. All these stories, they, you know, I tell you that Darwin was not correct. Mendel was not correct. We are not coming from our previous generation. We frighten people. Did your father have diabetes? Then you will have diabetes. You suddenly have diabetes. your connection with your father is not even 1 by 1 million zeros 1%. Because in your human chromosome, you only have 18,000 to 23,000 human genes. But 2.5 trillion germ genes. So your contribution from your parents is 18 divided by 2.5 trillion. Can you believe that? What will be the number? Nothing. Yeah. Chartered accountant, they can calculate it. They can calculate it in head. I was very bad in mathematics. I didn't know how to calculate 2 plus 2. So my teacher used to hit me. So I can't calculate. But these boys can calculate, so in no time, see, is it next to nothing? Nothing actually. Not next to nothing. It's nothing. So we don't have to frighten people. That poor Angelina Jolie, they removed her breast, saying that your auntie had cancer, you will get cancer, so let us remove your breast and give you a better breast. She had a beautiful breast, but they gave her a break. Two people made business, one surgeon to remove it, then another plastic surgeon to reconstruct it, cancer surgeon to do it. Then they said, now you also got a gene for ovaries, so they removed her ovaries. So I wrote an article, I said, at this rate, Angelina Jolie will be left only with her bones. Anybody can get it. Now they say, there is no genetic thing in cancer at all. This BRCA1, etc. has no meaning at all. But we still make money. That is where the problem is. You know where the problem started for medicine? Then money started coming. Time was when doctors, there were no hospitals in Europe. And Europe was the first hospital. Up until 18th century, there were no hospitals. And doctors used to go to patients' house to see patients. And the rule was, the ethics was, you go, thank the house for giving you an opportunity to help a human being in distress, examine the patient, prescribe, and then go to wash your hands. In the wash basin, there are usually 3 guineas were kept. Guinea is 1 pound per shilling. It's a gold coin. So 3 guineas are kept in the wash basin. That means the household is rich enough to give you money. You pocket that quietly, thank them once again and go. When you go to wash, there is no guinea kept. That means the household cannot afford it and you won't have anything. You again wash your hands, go inside again and thank them because they have given you an opportunity to help somebody. And that was the day. Then came the hospitals in the 18th century. And those days the hospitals were like the hospitals today. Whoever goes to the hospital goes to heaven. That was called hospitalism. Today most people go to hospital and get into the ICU, go to heaven. Because that's what's called nosocomial infection. If you are an elderly person, you go there irrespective of what it is, you have a fracture or something like that, you get a pneumonia and then that germ kills you because no antibiotic touches that germ and you directly go to heaven. And the worst part is, for those days you can't even talk to your relatives. You wanted to say something but you are inside the glass cage and the doctor says, no, you can't go inside. How many of you have seen that one Malayalam film which is translated, dubbed into English, not Hindi, Drishyam or something?
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you seen that?
Yeah.
That's exactly what happens in the hospital. They take a dead body from a government hospital and then deal it in a hurry in an ambulance to the private hospital. Then immediately the doctor comes and says, oh, he's serious, put him in the intensive care unit. They keep him in the intensive care unit for 3 days and they make a lot of fuss around it. And then, you know, lot of medicines are prescribed and the person goes to the shop and buys it and then it's taken back to the intensive care and the patient is dead. So it will go back to the same the shop and then all these people get commission in it and they make money. Exactly. I tell you, I didn't see the Malayalam one. Malayalam I'm told is better because this fellow Kamal Hassan is acting. Now who? Ajay Dev. He did very well. Ajay Dev for a change had done very well. Otherwise he is only a fighter. But here he has done very well. But see this, you must see that. Or I would suggest you get a film called Sicko. C-I-C-K-O. Sicko. It's a 1.5 hour documentary. Please screen it one of these days here. You will know what exactly is American medicine all about. This is Michael Moore's beautiful documentary. One of the fantastic documentaries. And you can see how we fleece patients in the hospital most of the time. Especially in America and in India. You can't do that in Gulf countries because there's so much of checks and balances here. In India there's nothing. No asker, no teller. Simply charge. Whatever you want. One injection of imitinab, 2.5 lakhs. It's not even passed by the FDA. So this is what how we are doing it. And what we are doing with that is simply tyrosine kinase receptor inhibitor, which turmeric has much more than that injection. Ginger has more of tyrosine kinase receptor inhibitor than that injection. So if you give turmeric and ginger, probably if that's a medicine for cancer, it should cure cancer. So don't get frightened, number one. What is the message so far? Do not get frightened of diseases. Diseases don't kill you. You will die on the day you are destined to die. And if you happen to have a disease at that time, well and good. If not, you will die anyway. I had a neighbor, poor chap. His job was, E-Road milk comes to Mangalore in the morning at 4:30. He will go in his either auto rickshaw, either driver, and he has got a big can. He will buy one can of milk, and then he has got that measure, and go from house to house selling that milk. One day, his driver didn't come. It's so vivid in my mind. It was about 5 o'clock, not rainy season, it was summer, not even a breeze. This fellow said he'll be late for the railway station, so he took the auto rickshaw himself. He just moved about 50 yards. His own coconut tree, which was standing there for years together, suddenly fell right on his head and he died there. No illness, nothing. So you don't have to have an illness to have. So if you get an illness, don't think you're going to die. But you're going to suffer. So that suffering, if you can avoid, it's good. But that suffering does not go with our medicines. All that you require is the faith in the doctor. Did you understand that? It's called the placebo effect. Recently, a big study was done whether this placebo effect is true or not. In 4 universities together, Oxford, Cambridge, Hamburg and Munich. And 8 professors collectively did a study for 4 years prospectively, led by the professor of medicine in Oxford, Dr. Bingham. And this study, they took the severest pain possible, severest pain, and ran a drip of morphine. According to our textbooks, it's the biggest pain killer known to mankind, right? But told the patient, this is not morphine. This is a new vitamin we have discovered for relieving pain, but immediately pain may not go because it's not morphine. Would you believe 88% of the patient, the pain never went? He was having a drip of morphine. Then they took the patient, what's called the crossover study, and ran a drip of saline, salt water. You get the glucose saline. Ran it and said, this is morphine. The latest salt of morphine, and your pain will go. 100% pain went. And they were surprised. Researchers themselves are surprised. So they said something wrong. So they did fMRI, concurrently fMRI, repeated the study. fMRI tells you what the brain is doing. Okay, functional MRI. So they were doing fMRI and giving the repeating the study. What they saw was when the patient believed that it's not morphia, mark my words, when the patient believed that it's not morphia, the brain slept. When the patient believed it is morphia, the forebrain produced such powerful opioids, much more powerful than opium, that the pain simply went. See, this is the real placebo effect. Way back in the 19th century, there was a physician in Boston who studied in Harvard, taught in Harvard, left medicine, saying that medicine is a bad science, and started writing poems. His name is Oliver Wendell Holmes, who said, the two most powerful drugs mankind has ever invented are the two kind words of a humane doctor. Today doctors have no time for patients. You can't talk to them. They won't talk to you. And one very great professor of mine in London, he wrote, if you listen to your patient long enough, he will tell you what is wrong with him. Absolutely true. You listen to the patient long enough, talk to him. Don't talk to him, listen to him. That's called talking with the patients, not just listening, not talking to patients. I'm talking to you. I'm not talking with you. No, I'm trying to tell you what I know. That's the most foolish thing. Let the patient talk and the disease will come out. And this I have practiced for more than half a century now. I know how true it is. His name was Lord Plot. We used to practice exactly what he said. So this is where you have to understand that your faith in the doctor is important. Not his degree, not who he is, not whether he has got a Padma or no Padma. What is important is you have faith in him or not. And if you have faith in him, any doctor is as good as any other doctor, irrespective of what degree he has. I can give you any number of instances. Doctors who have hardly studied any medicine. You know, somebody has a LIM when about 70 years ago, he wouldn't have known what where the head is, where the leg is. These are so, you know, successful doctors. My own doctor in my village was an LIM. I'll tell you, when I was a child, it was in the 40s, 30s, late 30s and 40s. And he was an LIM in 40 and studied must be in the 19th century. And he was, I still remember four or five colored mixtures he used to have. Whatever happens, you go to him, one day it's red mixture, one day it's green mixture. And you're all right. I still remember when I was a student in the 50s in Madras, ours was the biggest hospital in Asia. Just opposite our hospital, there was one Mangalore doctor called U.N. Narayana. You go through that? Mohan Rai Rappa. U.N. Narayana was a very famous doctor. LIM, I'm talking of 1955, when he studied must be in 1895 or something like that. They don't teach anything. And his queue opposite our hospital, was about 2,500 to 3,000 patients in the morning. His patients were about 2,000. He was in Park Town, and the queue starts in Paris Corner, if you know Petra City. From Paris Corner, from Thondiyarpet, Tiruvathiyur patients come in the morning and line up right through that and Chinatown and then come to Park Town. Every day they come. And this man is deaf. He was about 75 at that time. He is deaf. And he had a long stethoscope where the tubes are blocked. And he won't touch the patient because he's, all the patients are stinking. They don't take bath at all. So he'll have an assistant who will take the stethoscope's chest piece to the patient. And there are three rooms. You know, patients come there, put their bottles, and the bottles are taken to the other room. Some mixture is put into some bottle. And you walk into your Narendra's room. Enna? By the time he says Enna, he has kept the stethoscope. Then he passes. That's all. One word. And they get better. Otherwise, they won't come next year. I've been seeing this for 5 years, I'm shocked. What is this man doing? Why am I studying all this bullshit? So, all comes at the end of the day, your faith in the doctor. That's how quacks try. Because quacks have a lot of sympathy. That's why I tell my students, whether you practice allopathy, homopathy, ayurveda, homeopathy, doesn't matter. I practice sympathy and empathy. So now, did you get all courage? Now we'll come back. Said whether jealousy is the cause and things like that, let us look at it. The new biology makes the human body a closed system. Now it's called systems biology, which you're not studying in your school. I didn't study in my school either. Systems biology, the closed system, vis-a-vis the open system. We in the Western medicine think the human body is an open system. But the truth is the human body is a closed system. Difference is very simple. I'll give you a simple definition. If I explain to you what's closed system, open system, you'll be confused. Because you must have studied biology. You, in the olden days, you wanted hot water for a bath in the morning. You had to take a bucket of cold water, put a heater inside there. When the water gets heated, you had to remove the heater. Which is for everything, somebody has to interfere from outside. Today you have the geyser, you switch it on, water gets heated, when it's hot, it gets switch off and then cools down, you get switched on. So anytime you can walk into the bathroom and get the water, hot water comes. Hotels and all. That is a closed system. Closed system looks after itself. It has got a thermostat. It has got a doctor. So you and I are made, when we are made by our maker, with the inbuilt doctor, which is called the immune system. What a beautiful concept. Why did this happen? I'll give you a little background so that you understand. We were hunter-gatherers in the forest. Only two causes of death, old age and predation. Tiger will eat you, or maybe lion will eat you. So nature, if you are an atheist, or God, if you are a theist, gave you a protection in the form of autonomic nervous system. You see a tiger, and then suddenly your sympathetic system gets stimulated. You secrete adrenaline, which goes to the liver, releases glucose from the glycogen. So you get glucose, your blood sugar goes up to run. Otherwise, P.T. Usha runs with the glucose aid. There is no glucose aid in the forest. So, God provided the glucose aid. Your heart rate has to go up if you have to run. So, you get chronotrophic, the heart rate goes up. Your blood pressure has to go up if you have to run. So, your blood pressure goes up. You know, your cholesterol goes up, your steroids go up, everything, you must get energy. Now you will run to save your life from the tiger. Tiger will still catch you. So while running, all these things come down. Now today we transformed ourselves in the last 10,000 years into what is called society. But it put a RMJ, not much time, so you're not missed much. So, what happens? Today you transform yourself into society. We're all civilized people, love one another, you are supposed to love one another, etc., etc. But we really hate each other. And in the olden days, we used to live in a home built in love. Today, you live in an apartment which keeps you apart. The next neighboring fellow dies after 6 days and he smells only you here. Because you're not even seen him. This is the problem. So what happens now? We have a lot of tigers in this society. Wife may be a tiger, husband may be a tiger, boss may be a tiger, assistant may be a tiger, your colleague may be a tiger. Always a tiger. So when you see the tiger, same things happen. Your reference goes up. I'm not joking, I'm seriously telling you, make it a little lighthearted. What happens? Now, all these things go up because you think that person is a tiger. Now, in the olden days, what used to happen? You run away from the tiger, and these things used to come down. Today, you can't run away from the tiger. Your boss is a tiger. You have to be there for getting your salary. So, you get sustained elevation of blood pressure, blood sugar, cholesterol, steroid, etc., etc. Now, immediately go to the doctor. Doctors are taught that there is a pill for every ill. So, he gives a pill for bringing it down. What happens? It might not come down, or it might come down. But your fear and the tiger doesn't go. The real treatment for this lifestyle diseases is change of mode of living and tranquility of mind. Drugs, comma, rarely ever, comma, if ever, full stop. This is what is written in 1773 in the first textbook of medicine written by a young doctor called Charles Schaffschmitz in Vienna, which was the mecca of medicine in the 18th century. This boy was from Volga Valley in Russia. He was not a son of the soil. He is not because he is a son of the soil. He became the professor of medicine at the age of 26 in Vienna, which was a mecca of medicine in those days. He was brilliant. So after passing his MD, he became the professor of medicine. He wrote this textbook where he said, I have seen patients with vehement agitation of the mind and spastic constriction of the vascular bed, because he didn't have that box. Today doctors have a push box, which has killed a lot of people. But he didn't have the box. But he said, spastic constriction of vascular bed, that means your blood pressure has gone. But he said, what's the treatment? Change of mode of living. You have to change your lifestyle. Then he said, tranquility of mind. Then he said, drugs rarely ever, if ever. Now you know why the blood pressure goes up. People don't know that. You think blood pressure is a disease? Very interesting. I shouldn't tell you the tricks of the trade. All of you studied PUC, right? Plus two, right? Ni padicha thambi? Illa, hey, please go. Then the physics teacher tells you, laminar flow cannot produce lateral pressure because cosine 90 is zero. So if it produces lateral pressure, it can't flow. Hey sir, niye physics padichinga? Question chulli kudukala cosine la ke? Illa. So he marks it up, CET first try. Goes to the medical college, professor of physiology comes. The lateral pressure exerted by the flowing blood on the vessel wall is called blood pressure. This fellow has forgotten what he is taught in physics. Because he mucked it up, mucking up, it goes off immediately after the exam. And he has not understood that, he didn't try to understand that. And when the professor thought, he is right. So, if it is a laminar flow, it can't produce lateral pressure. So, it's not the blood pressure that he is pushing. What he is seeing is the volume of blood in the segment. Supposing you know you are a woman delivering, you bleed a lot, your blood pressure falls because your volume has gone down. Supposing I overload you with fluids in the intensive care unit, your blood pressure goes up and you die of heart failure. We don't think, you know, because our education system is such that after you go to kindergarten class, you stop thinking. You have to exactly replicate what is written in the book. I had a grandson who was born a girl. So this boy was very brilliant, I should be saying that. he will such ask such difficult questions when he was small, you know, 3 years ago. Raja, why is this bird red in this? Why is it doing like that? You know, those days he came back to India. His parents came back and he went to our school. After that, you ask him any questions. Raja, don't worry, I have to mug up this book. And first, he had not studied Kannada at all, and he comes here to study Kannada. First exam, he failed. Why? There was I still vividly remember, there's a chapter called Obavanu Onakeri Vadidaru. How many of you are Kannada? You can understand? Okay, good, good. There was some Obava, I mean, I don't know who this Obava is. In some fort of a king or somewhere, she Onakeri is.
Chitradurga.
Ah, whatever, whatever. Onakke, you know, Onakke is Ujjain. RC. So, Onakke, this boy wrote, Onakke, zero mark. Because in the book it is, Obon, Onakke, how can you write Onakke, Obon? That is why Alexis Carrel, Nobel laureate surgeon, wrote in his book, Man the Unknown, every newborn child is a genius, which is true. Every child born is a genius. If you want scientific proof, I'll tell you later, not in the lecture. Only to be converted into an idiot in school. Absolutely. This is our situation. So, the students don't think, doctors don't think, and we carry on whatever is put on our back. We are like the donkeys, a washerman's donkeys, taking the cloth from the washerman's house to the river and back. Never asking what's on my back, whatever you put on my back, whatever he puts, we carry. So whatever is written in the textbook, and recent research showed all textbooks in medicine are written by drug company money. And the professors are bought to say, he's the editor-in-chief, he's author, and he's given about $5 or $10 million, and then they say, oh, BMAG is textbook professor. BMAG doesn't know a damn about what's written. The drug company is right that this drug is for every disease under the sun. And now the US Supreme Court has permitted them that if you get an FDA permission for a drug for any disease, you can use it for any other disease. See, this is the most dangerous. I don't know how a court can give a judgment like that. How do the judges know what a drug is? How do they know what it is? You know why they give it. That's a different thing. We'll not go into that because it will be contempt of court. So that's where we have come. So don't get frightened, number one. Number two, we are not monkeys to be man now. No, that old story of biology is gone. We have in this world is 4 billion years old. First 2 billion years, this world was inhabited by germs. All kinds of germs. But they were like us, you know, like our stage now. We are fighting with each other, ego, one-upmanship, I'm more, he is less, I want to be more, and they killed each other. And eventually they realized, hating each other is no good, so they mutated to love each other. Then they didn't have food to eat, and they did a great experiment. They created chlorophyll,